people are still not sure here in the clinic what this building is meant for, what it should be used for.
When I saw the maquette and I saw there was no roof, no windows, I thought, oh, what the hell, that's got to be the building without a roof. So I was a bit skeptical at the beginning.
When a psychiatric hospital is too clinical, then it doesn't work. If you ask me what is the definition and function of this building, well, it's a space of possibilities where it is the patient, the visitor, the co-worker who uses it, who defines the space. When I arrived here 6 years ago, one of the issues I was responsible for was the master plan, because this is built in 1908. The architect that we were collaborating with wanted to tear down all the buildings and build a new hospital. We did not agree because we thought these buildings were very precious. So we invited Gideon and I asked him, well, Gideon, can we walk through the campus? Eh? I will tell you about mental health care, the challenges we are facing with, and you have to try to make the link to qualitative space and architecture.
Having my first visit with the director here on site, we were walking around, and one of the things he asked me was what to do in this empty ocean of green when this building will be gone.
And I told him, well, Gideon, I think you know the answers, but I can't ask the proper questions.
The funny element is that I report saying, of course, we're in a mismatch, you don't need me, but I can help you in organizing participative workshops, gathering everybody here to discuss about the future for this psychiatric campus.
There were board members, there were patients, there were visitors, there were people out of the neighborhood, there were doctors, there were directors, and so on. And together we thought about quality of space.
The demolition of this building and three other buildings here in the central axis of the campus, it was not even part of the discussion. This was something that was already decided.
And the bulldozer has already made a hole into the wall there downstairs. But the director said, oh, it's a pity, we can't destruct the building. We have to do something with it, but I don't know what we can do with it.
We experienced a lot of frustration among the people. So everybody had a history that was attached to this building. It was an icon because of its central position. So this is how, in fact, the project came into being. It was never, in fact, commissioned. It was a sort of sidetrack next to a participative discussion on the qualities that a psychiatric campus needs.
We wanted to make a ruin of it, and to make it a public place of meeting, to have theater, music, and so on.
Everybody was asking for open spaces, spaces with high ceilings, spaces where a lot of light come in, spaces with a lot of doors, so it's easy to leave the building and come back again. The patients were complaining that there was no attraction point outside the buildings. They had no space to go. Let's say in between the openness of this campus and the closeness of a building, people were fantasizing about an in-between space. The youngsters were asking for a space to play hide and seek. One lady said, why don't you make a wailing wall, like in Jerusalem? But the lady next to her, she said, there's enough wailing here in the clinic. I want a wishing wall. We put it all together in a sort of surrealist bricolage of fantasies.
Therefore, we organized a competition between architects.
The design that was selected then was a provocative proposal because they didn't start from the idea that, in fact, what we need here is a bit of a sort of ruined space. They said, let's take the building as we find it at that moment, let's say to do the first essential interventions at this moment, for instance, taking out some rotten parts of the floor, and then to see what happens in the coming years.
So we were invited by the architects on a gathering to share some ideas about the building.
It works both sides. The architect influences us, but we and all the people who live here at Caritas influences the architect.
There was one central idea, and that was it had to be some kind of free place. In the brainstorm, we decided we have to have some isolated places in the big place. And for that, the glass houses came. Some would be for artwork, some would be to have a projection room or to listen to music. So it was open, but at the same time, you could find some privacy.
As you see the building, in fact, of course, it has a sort of front facade, but in the design by the architect in the Ville de Victailleux, in fact, the building had to be presented to all sides. So even the side facades or the back facade had to function as a sort of front, so that it becomes easy for people to walk in and walk out. And this often happens. We get this feedback by people saying, hey, we went to Melle to see the Caritas building, but we didn't find anybody. I mean, what are people expecting? That the psychiatric center would be a lively sphere here? That people would enjoy and walk around like at the Ramblas? I always answer then, but you are the user. You are the one who came to see this building and to wander around. Not long, 1 hour, but this is also what the patients do when they go to the restaurant to have lunch. They take a break of 4 or 5 minutes, sit in the sun, and they disappear again.
Sometimes patients organize here something, and often it's on the fire. Come with guitar and they play some songs, they sing together.
It's not defined. It's so open, and it makes you have to be creative about it. And it brings people together also. That's what makes this building so special. Everybody can give an accent to this building.
Not a well-defined building. It's weird. It's annoying. It's a building without a roof. Who wants to go in a building without a roof? So many people ask me, well, Herman, when are you going to repair the roof? Oh, no, we will not repair the roof. What is it then?
I used, for instance, the place on the first floor to give group therapy. And it gives also another dimension to a therapy.
There was a young patient who had all kinds of ideas of have expression sessions here, having dance meetings and so on. Eh? And he asked me if he could experiment with it. Well, I told him, of course you can, please use it.
It has something special. When I come in, I always want to play paintball. Because I always thinking, oh, it's a nice place to do, yeah, paintball.
People with psychological vulnerabilities have difficulty in dealing with that kind of ambiguity. So it's asked too much to them to say, wow, what a beautiful building, that is nice. But on the other hand, the building, well, it's a little bit like a transitional space for sense making. The building has all kinds of scars. These are a little bit metaphoric for what is happening with our people with psychological vulnerabilities too. Talking about it, making sense out of it, is also psychotherapeutically an important issue.
It's sometimes melancholic, but it's also sometimes very cozy. When there are a lot of people downstairs at the open fire, it's really ambience. So it has different feelings.
It has also some sobriety, some historic dimension. So it doesn't bother me that it has some melancholy. It fits in our Flemish culture.
Of course, this building has a romantic attraction to people who are thinking about doing a suicide attempt.
And therefore we had to make a compromise between architecture and safety.
It's also the reason why at a certain moment the staircases were closed. The director told me, one patient approached him saying, but what the hell with this chain? You don't trust us anymore. It's in fact a building that was meant to create another image about psychiatric care that somehow functioned as a reinstalling of the old stigma that we put on patients. The wonderful conclusion was we opened up again the staircase, so now again the first floor is open for everybody.
In psychotherapy, becoming is much more important than being. So what it will become will be the result of a dialogue between people, but also a dialogue with the building by using it. Maybe it doesn't have to evolve and it's okay. But I think it will evolve.
People also change by getting older. And I think this building changes with the people who use it. But the painful, I want to do it sometimes.